said, it's a great pleasure to be here because it's my hometown, and I'm very happy to come back to visit Kristev. And the topic I'm going to talk about today is contextuality. Now, contextuality is something which is very widely studied in the foundations of physics. But I thought that today I'm not going to focus very narrowly on quantum theory, which is my own research field. But I would like to show you different examples how contextuality pops up in different parts of natural sciences, social sciences, and humanities. So the hidden aim of my talk is to motivate especially young researchers to have a look at what this strange thing is which physicists call contextuality. Now, there is a little problem with the Okay, here is the main message which I would like to convey. Contextuality is the possibility to extend local descriptions of an object to a unified global description. If it sounds very abstract, I would like to show you a very simple example just to have an idea what contextuality is. Here is the example. Suppose you are given three perspectives of a geometrical object. This is the view taken from above, the top view, and here are the two side views of this object. I give these perspectives to you and ask you to imagine what kind of geometrical spatial object is the one the perspectives are here. And after some time you can figure it out that this is a pyramid. So it has to be a pyramid because it's a rectangle from above, and it's this is a triangle from the one side and triangle from the other side. So it's very easy to put together these perspectives and to represent somehow the spatial object from these perspectives. But now suppose that the three things which the three perspectives which I give you are these. Should I do? So it's a rectangle from above. It's a triangle from the one side, and it's a circle from the other one. What kind of object is that? And you need to figure out what is this object. So it can be a pyramid from that side, but how can it be that if you take a look at it from the other side, it's a circle? And after some consideration, you get to the conclusion that such a spatial object, such a spatial object, doesn't exist. So I gave you three perspectives of an object which cannot be combined in a consistent way, such that at the end you end up with an object out there in space. Now this is contextuality. So you are sometimes can be given descriptions of a phenomena such that when you try to put them together and you want to conceptualize what kind of object is in the middle which you are talking about, you get into trouble. Here is my simple example. Suppose there is an object in a box. You don't know what kind of box is that. And you want to determine four properties of the object: the size, the color, the shape, and whether it's heavy or not. But suppose you can raise only two of the four questions at the same time. Okay. And good. So what you do is I would like to give you a geometrical representation of this contextual way of thinking. So here's a rectangle with the questions. I suppose that you first ask the first two questions of the core, A and B. So is the object big, or and is it black? And you get two possible answers. One answer is yes to both questions. Yes, it is big and black. Or the other option is that you get a no to both questions. So it's not big, so it's small. Suppose that these are binary questions, so an object can be either big or small. And same for the color. Good. So what you have in mind at this point, that in the box there is either a big and black object, or there is a small and white object. These are the two options. Good. Let's step one step further. And then you ask the second two questions, the color and the shape. And again, what you get is either a yes, denoted by one, or a zero, denoting no. So at this point, you think that the object has to be either big and black and round, or it has to be small and white and cubic. Okay, you do the fourth one, or the third one, the third pair. It is the A prime and B prime, and again, you get the same answer. So at this point, you think that you know everything about the object. The object is either a big, black, round, and heavy thing, or the negation of these four. So you do a force checking experiment, checking the A and the B prime. And indeed, you get these answers. Yes or no. After these four perspectival descriptions, you want to unite all the descriptions, and you want to say what kind of object is in the box, and you end up with the following figure. This is what I just told you. Either all of the object has all the four properties, or it doesn't have any of them. Now suppose you do the experiment again. To the first question you get the same answer. To the second pair of questions you get again the same answer. For the third one, again the same answer. But for the fourth, suppose the answer is this. So when you ask whether the object is round and heavy, the answer to this question is that it's either round, but then it's not heavy, or it's heavy, but it's not round. Now suppose you cannot perform all the four experiments on the object. You can raise only two other questions for, say, physical reasons. What do you do in this case? So what kind of object is that? What you are talking about? What is in the box? So how can you conceptualize this, the result of these four different pairs of questions? Can you put them together to get a kind of objective description of what's going on out there in the world? Or it puts a limit on your unificatory approach. If you want to do the unification, you end up with something like this. if you start from here, and you say, okay, it's an object which is, maybe let's start from here, which is big. Then it has to be black, but then it has to be round, so it has to be heavy, but then it cannot be big. So you get a contradiction. So this is the essence of a very typical scenario, which was, I think, first discovered in quantum theory, but which is now universally applied in many, many different fields of sciences and of the humanities. And I would like to give you several examples where this kind of contextuality can pop up and how you can handle such things. Let me start with logics. This is the famous liar paradox. Now, you don't have four questions, but you have four propositions. And these propositions are such that they refer to one another. Okay, so A is a proposition that the next proposition, namely B, is true. B is a proposition and that A prime is true, and so on, except the last one, which states that the next proposition in the circle, in the A, is false. Okay. Now, can you give a unified valuation, as logicians say, of these propositions? So, can you assign truth values to the propositions, true or false, such that they give you a consistent description? No. The reason is just as before. Actually, the logic is just as before, starting from a true proposition. So, accepting that A is true, B has to be true. But if B is true, then A prime has to be true, which makes B prime to be true. But in the last step, if B prime is true, then A has to be false. So you get into a vicious circle. So contextuality is a nice way of telling the liar paradox. Actually, the well-known liar paradox is such a paradox where you don't have to step four to get back, but in one step you get back. So you have just an A which states from itself that it's false. Okay. So the liar paradox in the literature is a special subcase of this contextuality. So the visual picture behind this contextuality is the Möbius strip, where you somehow put a twist in the evaluation of the different descriptions, and this causes the problem. So this makes it impossible to evaluate all the propositions or to answer all the questions in a consistent way. But this is just one very typical contextuality. You can imagine different types of contextualities in which you have double twist, or you have many different type of topological subtleties which cause this kind of problem of objectifying that description. Good. Now, let me talk a little bit about quantum theory, just to show you the provenance of this question, or of this problem. So, a brief history for those who are not very familiar with quantum theory. It started in the beginning of the 20th century, with Planck's discovering the energy quantum, namely that the energy transfer happens in discrete quantas, Then comes Einstein, who identified his quantas with the photons. In 56 comes Heisenberg and then Schrödinger, two famous theoretical physicists who solved all the theoretical challenges which then finally led to the theory of quantum mechanics. And in 27, 27 is the date of the uncertainty principle, which is which made maybe the first real challenge for philosophy in quantum theory. There are many different applications. I just listed some practical and theoretical applications of quantum theory here. So what I'm using here is based on quantum theory, from semiconductor physics to data and GPS, whatever. And in theory, you have many applications of quantum theory. There is a technique, a special technique called to quantize a theory, which means that if you are given a classical description of a phenomena, whatever phenomena it is, you can apply a specific procedure to quantize this description, meaning that you end up with a quantum mechanical description of the same phenomenon. So it's a huge technique, and it's applied to geometry, cosmology, whatever, and also in social sciences. I will talk about that later. But today, what I'm interested in is the philosophical aspect of quantum physics. So, simply, the question: what does quantum mechanics mean? So, what are the philosophical foundations of quantum theory? Now, let me just mention two names, or actually four names, which are the milestones in these foundations of physics business. The one is the so-called EPR, Einstein-Pillowski-Rosen paradox. I will tell you about in the next slide. This is a it's a paper written by Einstein and two of his colleagues, and at this point, Einstein tried to argue that quantum mechanics, in a very fundamental sense, is incomplete.
Is
incomplete. So
incomplete. Yes.
It cannot be. It's not a physically complete theory. I cannot get into this very interesting point, but it was the first paper which launched this whole research program in the foundations of physics, where enabled to understand quantum mechanics. And in 30 years after, John Stuart Mill, a very famous physicist, invented a technique, a mathematical technique, based on which you can do what is called experimental metaphysics. So you can very sophisticatedly and very analytically ask precise questions, fundamental and very important philosophical questions. You pose them and you can answer them in quantum theory. Let's see this EPR case. So this is the birthplace of contextuality. I'll tell you the experiment very, very briefly. You are given pairs of electrons, and these electrons are flying apart, one to the right and the other to the left. And you perform measurements on pair. This measurement is called the spin measurement. So these electrons have an intrinsic property called spin. visualize the spin as a rotation around an axis, and because the electrons the charged particle, therefore it's a kind of current. Okay? But it's quantum mechanics, it's quite a complicated thing what spin is, but it's a good visualization. So you want to measure the spin of these flying electrons. So what you do is you send these electrons in a magnetic field. Now, in a magnetic field, a charged particle, a spinning charged particle, can go either in the direction of the field or in the opposite direction. So these are the two options an electron can take. Depending which of the exits the electron chooses, we call the electron having the spin up or down. Okay, so the experiment is the following. An electron is coming, you drive the electron into a field, and if it goes upwards, you say that the result of the experiment, the outcome of the experiment is up. If it goes in the other direction, you say that in that direction, the spin of the electron is down. Okay? Now, the two electrons are flying in opposite directions, so you perform a measurement here and you perform a measurement over there. The two magnetic fields cannot be parallel, need not be parallel to one another. So you can freely choose in which direction you measure the electron here and there. Okay. So you perform a measurement on the pair and you get answers. So these are the one possible direction of the electron. Suppose you do the following. You pick two directions here, two arbitrary directions, say this one and that one, and two directions there. Now, at the one side, say at the right side, you have to choose between the two directions. You cannot perform both measurements because the magnetic field has to direct it either in one direction or in the other direction. It cannot be in both. Okay. So you have to decide what to choose. This brings in contextuality because you cannot have a full information of the electron. You can have partial informations by choosing between the different directions. So take one direction here, and you pick another direction there, and you perform the measurement. You get probabilities. Quantum mechanics is full of probabilities, as sociology. And good. Then you take another pair. Say you keep the direction on the left hand side, and then change it on the right hand side. You do the experiment in such a way. Again, you get probabilities. And then you take all the four possible combinations. But remember, among the four questions, you can ask only two at the same time. And this gives you just the logic which I showed you before. Okay? You have four questions. You would like to raise all the four questions to the electrons, but you just cannot, because experimentally it is impossible to raise all the four questions, only two of them, and you get a partial description of the electrons based on these four different pairs, and then comes the challenge whether you can unify these descriptions. What does unification mean in this sense? Unification means that somehow you can tell what kind of objective properties, namely spin properties, the electron has. Okay? So this objectification is a step from the outcomes of the measurement to the properties of the electrons. So these two things are not the same. The outcome is the outcome of an experiment, and the property is a is a metaphysical category of the electron, what the electron has. Okay? And it turns out that you cannot make this step. So from the partial descriptions, you cannot go down to the electron, to the level of the electron, and say what kind of properties, pre-existing properties, the electrons have. Okay. And this was the first encounter with this kind of contextuality in, I think, in the history of science. And it's very shocking. Actually, it's more shocking than the other one because it brings in another element, which is locality, in that the two electrons are far away from each other. So it makes the make things more complicated. But I don't want to bring in this extra component. Good. Here's a structurally analogous version of the EPR experiment used in psychology. It's called the double detection task. So now I'm shifting from natural sciences to social sciences and humanities. So I tell you what is the experiment here. The experiment was the following. It was done by a Japanese group in 2014 or so. The participants were given two circles on a computer screen with a dot, with two dots, either in the middle of the circles or a little bit displaced of the center. Okay? And they were asked to tell whether the dot is in the middle or not. So they had to give a double answer, like yes, yes, meaning that yes, they are both in the middle, or yes, no, meaning that the left is in the is at the center of the right is not. Okay? Now, what are the contexts? Contexts were the different arrangements, namely that there were actually four different contexts. The one was that in which both dots were put in the middle, the other when none of them, and the two others were just the right or the left dot. Was placed in the middle of the circle. And it's structurally just the same as the spin measurement. Here, locality doesn't play a role because the participant has to give an answer because one participant has to give an answer, so they are not spatially separated as in physics. And it turned out, and then the question was whether those inequalities, the Bell inequalities, which I mentioned a bit before, that I know about, whether these inequalities, which represent the necessary condition for the objectification of the outcomes, whether this inequality is satisfied or violated, and there's a huge a discussion now in the literature, because one group says that an evident example for contextuality in psychology, because the Bell inequalities are violated, and there's another group which says that up to now we haven't met any contextual description in social sciences. Okay, so I don't want to decide on this question at this point. I just wanted to show you that what kind of descriptions people are doing. There is another example from this third perception theory. Maybe I skip this one and then come back to this if you are interested in it in the discussion, because I show you something else. This is a well-known rock, paper, scissors example. I'm sure you all know the game. You have to show three of the of these symbols and the paper beats the stone, and the stone beats the beats scissors. Mm-hmm. So there is a local preference order, which cannot be extended locally. Now, again, here are some pictures. So the rock crushes scissors, and on this slide, then the scissors cut paper on this one. So B is above C, and here is the third one. The paper wraps rock. Okay, so you have these preference relations, and then you want to unify. Okay, so who is the winner? And it turns out that you cannot do the unification, because if you start from one and you accept the local preferences, then you end up with a contradiction. Okay. Now here's a picture. I'm sure really you all know this Escher page where this problem is. This problem seems to be visually solved. Maybe that's you have a preference, but still you can unify the stairs by coming back at the last point. But of course, it's not a logical solution of that problem. So here is another example from behavior studies, which has been studied by physicists in Brussels. There's a very nice school in Brussels. It's a Descartes school, where these physicists pick very different phenomena from social choice, linguistics, logics, whatever, and they try to apply quantum physics in the description of these phenomena. And this story about the lizards is one of the fields where they apply it. Now I tell you how it comes picture. So this lizard has three morphs: the orange throated, the blue throated, and the yellow throated. And this study surveys the mating behavior of these lizards. So, and it turns out that the orange one beats the blue one, because the orange is the most aggressive. It's with high level of testosterone, and he keeps a huge harem for himself, and therefore he outcompetes the less aggressive blue one. Okay. The yellow one is even less aggressive. So the blue one outcompetes the yellow one, because since the blue is not as aggressive as the orange one, it can form strong pair bonds, and therefore they can cooperate to defend their female. However, the yellow one outcompetes the orange one, because he does the following: the color of of the yellow one is very similar to the female, to the color of the females. And since the orange one tries to keep a huge territory, the yellow one just sneaks in and populates with the females. So therefore, if only two of them are present, then the yellow beats the orange one. So it's a rock, paper, scissors situation. It's a quite famous one in behavioral studies, where you have this strange kind of preference relations between them. And these guys in Brussels just calculated, I don't give you the details, but I just... convince you that it's a serious study, so I show you the numbers. So they computed what the probability of the orange beating the blue and so on. So what they did is they applied the whole quantum mechanical arsenal and tried to give a contextual description of the phenomenon. Good, and I end up with two photos, which I like very much. This is a photo of a Hungarian artist, Fülöp Schmal, who did the following, and then at the end I tell you how it relates to contextual. So Fülöp takes a projector and a camera. And he projects, say in a room or what is that, I don't know, bathroom, and he gets a rectangle on the wall. Now, if you look at the rectangle from different points, of course you will see the breaking of the lines, say on the wall or on the floor. However, if you look at the rectangle from the point where the projector is, you see only the rectangle itself. You don't see the breaking lines. So he put the camera right next to the projector, and he picked a long exposure time. So everything which was reflected became very, very light. So the forms within the rectangle completely disappeared. And at the end, it turned out that it seems as if this rectangle would stand in the space in the middle of the room, and he enhanced the effect by pouring water on the floor so that the light coming back from the other floor should give extra optical illusion. So what I'm going to illustrate, in a sense, is that for me at least, this picture is about the own existence of a perspective. Okay. So you maybe it's not so as we thought throughout our, say, 300-year history of science, namely that whenever you have a perspectival description or many perspectival descriptions of a phenomena, you are forced to unify them and at the end, give a so-called God's eye view of a phenomena, which is independent of how you approach the phenomena. So this was the standard way of approaching the outer world, especially in physics. But what these contextual challenges are teaching us, I think, is that sometimes you have to stop before reaching this ideal point, and you have to be happy with partial description.